Please stand. God is good, amen. Are you guys ready to praise and worship this morning?
Let's enter in.
The blind man see, you make the lame man walk again.
Come on, church.
You cause the dead to rise.
Let's wake up this morning. Hey,
and that's why we dance in liberty, cause he's doing it all again. Oh, yeah, yeah, cause you're doing it all again.
See.
You make the lame man walk.
Make the lame man walk again.
You cause the dead to rise.
You cause the dead to rise.
And that's why we dance in liberty.
And that's why we dance in liberty.
But he's doing it.
Cause you're doing it all again.
Come on.
Oh, 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 oh.
Same God, he's still creating.
Still creating.
Same God, same God.
You're the same God.
He's chain breaking.
Chain breaking. The same God.
Hey, because you're doing it all again.
Cause you're doing it all again. You're doing it all again.
Oh. You won't change.
You won't change. You're the same God.
It's never ending. No.
Never ending. The same God.
Yes. You won't change.
You won't change. You're the same God.
Cause you're doing it all again.
Cause you're doing it all again.
Yeah. Yes, you are Lord.
Cause you're doing it all again.
Keep on blessing us, Father.
Cause you're doing it all again.
Cause you're doing it all again,
yeah, yeah.
Hey!
Cause you're doing it all again,
yeah, yeah. Yes, he is.
Cause you're doing it all again.
Yes, he's doing it, he keeps doing it.
Cause you're doing it all again.
You keep doing it all again.
Cause you're doing it all again.
Woo!
Cause you're doing it all again.
You keep doing it all again.
Cause you're doing it all again.
He keeps doing it all again.
Cause you're doing it all again.
The Lord is shining bright. Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, Lord. You can do it. You won't change. Yeah. You won't change. You're the same God. Oh, he's never ending. The same God.
Church, just declare that today.
Come right now. So you won't change.
You won't change. You're the same God.
He's never ending. He's never ending.
Never ending. The same God.
Yes, our God won't change.
You won't change. You're the same God.
He's never ending. Sing it out, say,
never ending, the same God.
Father, we declare,
you won't change.
You won't change, you're the same God.
Never ending,
never ending. Declare it, church.
Never ending, the same God.
Come on, quiet, let your voice sing it.
You won't change.
You won't change, you're the same God.
Let's sing it out.
Yes, you're doing it all again.
You're doing it all again.
Cause you're doing it all again.
Hallelujah.
Cause you're doing it all again.
We declare you're doing it all.
Cause you're doing it all again.
Yeah, yeah.
Cause you're doing it all again.
Yes,
yes you are.
Cause you're doing it all again.
Cause you're doing it all again.
Let's give it praise. Hallelujah.
Let's
just stay there for a minute.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. I was reading, we're going to welcome you to church, by the way. God bless you for being here. Those who are looking over line, we bless you too. And we want to declare right from the start that he's never changing. Same with that progression, Beth, for just a minute. Amen. He's never ending.
Hallelujah.
You know, man, I don't know what you face this week, but you might need to hear that message right now. He's never ending. He's never changing. I was reading, you know, we know some verses sometimes. Sometimes I know verses and then I'm like, where do I know that verse? And I had to go look for it. But that verse, he says, his promises are what? Yes. Say yes and amen. Someone say, he's doing it all again. Say,
because he's doing it all again.
I don't care what you face today. You declare this right now. Oh, he's doing it all.
Yes, he's doing it all again.
I don't care what you face today. Declare this today. He's doing it all. Say,
because he's doing it all again.
Come on, man, play with me. Oh, he's never changed. Just say,
he won't change.
He won't change. He's the same God.
Yes, he will. Sing it
with me.
Never ending.
Never ending. The same God.
Say, I'll sing it.
Give it praise. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Let's lift up our praises today, church. Come on. Thank you, God. We come to you, Father, as our source today. We don't go anywhere else but you, Lord. We're reminded as we stand before you, Father, that you're a holy God, and we come to worship you. Church, join me. Come on, let's worship him today. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, lift him up today. He's your Father. He's your Savior. He's given you promises that you can stand on today. Hallelujah. Oh, we worship you in this house, God. Come on, choir, worship him today. We bless your name, Jesus. He
a holy God. He's worthy of your praise. Come on, worship him today. Play that one more time. Come on. Oh, we bless your name, Jesus. We worship you in this house, oh God. We declare there's none like you, God. We stir our faith before you, Lord. We stir our faith before you, Lord. Father, we declare you're doing it all again. You're doing it all again. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. A thousand generations, they're bowing down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. You know the words, sing it, church. And all have gone before us, and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Well, lift your voice, your name. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, and your name, it stands above them all. And all thrones and dominions and all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. And the angels cry, if you walk in freedom,
if you walk in freedom, and if you bear his name, sing the song forever to the Lamb.
Come on, lift your praise. Sing a song.
We'll sing a song forever to the Lamb. And the angels cry,
holy, sing it.
Holy, all creation cry.
Your name
stands up.
church, just worship Him. Just take a minute and give You praise. Father, we bless You. We bless Your name, Jesus. Worthy are You, Lord. Declare He's worthy. Declare His worth today. You will always be holy forever, Lord Jesus. Your name is higher than anything, Lord God. Your name is greater. We declare, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank You, Jesus. Choir, sing it for me. And the angels cry.
And the angels cry. Holy, all creation's cries. Holy, You are lifted high. Holy,
lift Him up, church.
Holy forever.
Yes, yes. Hear Your people sing.
Hear Your people sing.
Father, we bless You.
Holy to the King of Kings.
Holy, holy.
Holy, You will always be. Holy, holy forever.
You will always be saved. Thank You, God. Father, never let us get so busy that we forget Your holiness, that we fail to be sensitive to who You are, Your greatness and Your power, Your dominion, Your authority over everything, Father, over all. We bless You in this house today. We decree holy, holy, holy. Church, say that with me. Holy, holy, holy are You, Lord. Holy are You, Lord God. Thank You, Father. Bless Your name. Bless Your name. Bless Your name, Jesus. Bless Your name, Father. Worthy are You, Jesus. Worthy are You, Lord. Worthy are You, Father. We seek Your face to God. We seek Your face today, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord, we bless Your name. You're worthy, Lord. You're worthy, God. Bless Your name, oh Lord. Holy God.
Walking around walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but You have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won. For You have never failed me yet.
Yes, church, say that. The promises.
Your promise still stands. Great is Your faithfulness.
Your faithfulness.
I'm still in Your hands. This is my confidence.
Thank you.
Lift your voice, church.
Your promise is still. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Faithfulness.
Still in your hands.
I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail.
Your promise is still.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness.
Give him praise for that today, church.
He's never failed us. We're here to declare your name, Jesus. We're here to declare you're a faithful God. You're never ending your promises, oh Lord. Hallelujah. We bless your name.
Come on, church, let's declare this today. Oh, hallelujah. Lift your voice.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Faithfulness.
I'm still in your hands, Lord.
I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence.
One more time, say it again.
You never
your promise. Your promise.
Your promise still stands.
Great is your faithfulness, Lord.
Great is your faithfulness. Still in your hands, this is my confidence. You never fail me, yeah.
No, you never fail me, Lord. You've never failed me. Can you say that to him today, church?
Never fail me, yeah.
Tell him today, Father, you've never failed me. Say it again, church. Oh, you've
never failed me, yeah.
How many of you can say that today? How many of you believe that today? How many of you know that in your spirit today? Come on, let's lift up our hands and give him praise. Oh, we bless your name. Come on, church, all over the stage. Come on, lift your voice. Lift your voice today. Tell him he's a faithful God. You've never failed me, Lord. 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 Lift your voice, choir. We bless your name. Thank you, Lord. Come on, give him praise, church. We bless his name. He's a faithful God. His promises are always there for us. We're here to declare it in our hearts. We give you praise, oh Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Somebody lift your voice and declare, I've seen you move, say.
I've seen you move. You move the mountains. And I believe
you do it again. Thank you, Lord. How many of you believe what you just sang? How many of you need to believe it more? How many of you want to stir your heart for greater faith? Amen. You know, the Bible does say, Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. So all of us today stand before him and say the same prayer. Father, I believe you, but I need to believe you stronger. Help my unbelief today. Can you say that prayer with me before him? Oh, Father, strengthen our faith before you. For whatever is before us, we know that you are able, Lord. Your promises are always there. They're yes. They are yes and amen today. We worship you in this place today. And we thank you, Father. We thank you, Jesus. Now let's give him praise today. Come on, let's give him praise. Let's give him praise. Come on, church. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You know, in that same chapter that I was referring to, that Paul said, you know, his promises are yes and amen. Yes. In that same place, he's talking in the earlier part, he says, in fact, this is Paul saying, in fact, we expected to die. But as a result, we stopped relying on ourselves and learned to rely on God, who raises the dead. I mean, if he can raise the dead, he certainly can handle whatever we face. Amen. And I want you to read what he said. Hear what he said. And he did rescue us from mortal danger. And he will rescue us again. That's Paul. He said he rescued us. And he will rescue us again. We have placed our confidence in him. And he will continue to rescue us. He'll do it again, church. He'll do it again. He'll do it again. He did it before and he'll do it again. He'll do it again. Someone shout, he'll do it again. Hallelujah. Give him a shout of praise. Come on. Hallelujah. Father, we bless your name. All right, come on. Put your hands together. One more time. Come on. We
We're going to declare it. Let's declare it one more time. Yeah. Everybody said yes and amen. I want you to bless somebody near you. God bless you for worshiping.
Excited to be in church this morning. The presence of God is in this place, and it's always good to worship the Lord together corporately. Amen. Thank you for being with us this morning. Welcome to Church of All Nations. And if it's your first time, a special welcome to you. If it's your first time, can you just lift up your hands? We want to honor you. Come on, church. Can you welcome all of those whose first time it is? You can keep your hands raised. The ushers are going to come by and put something in your hand, and we just ask that you fill out that connect card, bring it out to our guest reception center out in the front breezer, and we'd love to connect with you, get to know you, and allow you to get to know us so that you can get connected with us. If you're watching online, thank you for tuning in. We're going to drop a connect card, a digital connect card there in the chat. That way you can get connected with us as well. It's a good day to be in church. Amen. Amen. If you didn't know, this past weekend, Thursday to Saturday, we got back last night. Our youth went to the District Fine Arts Festival, and man, it was an amazing time. They did well. You've seen them perform. They did an amazing job, and we just want to honor them, and we want to let you know the results, and thank you, first and foremost, for praying, for giving, for supporting us. Thank you for believing in the young people. I don't like to say the next generation, because they're the now generation as well. And so thank you for believing in the young people. Pastor Beth, thank you guys for believing in us as well. All of the categories that advanced to nationals were Hip Hop Dance Crew, Hip Hop Dance Solo by Angelina Charlotte, A Step Troop, Amy Pastrana's Short Sermon in Spanish, Brianna Pastrana's Short Sermon in Spanish, Amy Pastrana's Short Sermon in English, Stacy Joseph's short sermon, Felipe Dos Santos short sermon, Gabby Perez short sermon, the short film by Brianna called The Process, The Unconventional Percussion, Rachel Jean's female vocal solo, Karis Patrick, her 3D art and her 2D art painting and drawing, Felipe Dos Santos 2D painting and drawing, Brianna Pastrana's digital photography, Julissa Cherry's poetry, the choir and the musical theater all advance to the national so we can... Yes, they did a phenomenal job. Praise the Lord. And a few categories did place in the top three. A few of them are Hip Hop Dance Crew. They got first place. Brianna Pastrana, her short sermon in Spanish, got first place. Karis Patrick, her 3D visual art, got second place. Lucas Dos Santos, his brass solo, got second place as well. Brianna's digital photography got second place. Yes, and Amy Pastrana's short sermon in Spanish got third place. So shout out to all the youth. They did, again, a phenomenal job, and we're just so confident these giftings that they're able to develop. We're just so grateful for an event like Fine Arts, for the district, the Assemblies of God, Penn, Florida District, and for our church who believes in the now generation. So thank you, guys. One more time, can we give it up for all the young people, all the youth? Amen. Before we go to the video announcements, he's not in here because he's in Kids Wild, but today is P-Vic's birthday. So when you see him, say happy birthday. We want to say a special happy birthday to P-Vic. Yes. He told me he's 33 again, so I don't know what that means, but tell him happy 33rd birthday. But there is a lot of great things happening here at Church of All Nations. Turn your attention to the screens for this week's video announcements. God bless you, church. Good morning, and thank you for joining us. Let's check out all that we have here at Church of All Nations. Our community and fellowship groups, circles, have officially started. Have you signed up yet? Make sure to include your phone number when you sign up so our circle leaders can notify you of the next meeting. There's jogging, there's cooking, photography, and so much more. Head to the lobby after service and join a circle today. Church, mark your calendars for April 28th. It's our next Cone Cafe, hosted by our amazing choir. The theme is Little Italy, featuring a delicious menu of food like chicken marsala, baked ziti, and meatballs for just $15, and desserts for $3. Don't miss the next Cone Cafe on the 28th. We need the move of God in our lives and in our church. Once a month, our Wednesday night service will become a night of worship and prayer. Join us for the first Wednesday night of worship, May 1st at 7 p.m., right here in the main sanctuary. Join us as we seek the Lord and spend time in His presence in worship and in prayer. Our next Sunday school class, Christian Ethics, taught by Pastor Andres Montesino, is starting up soon. This is a free 10-week course that will examine the moral truths from a biblical perspective. Sign up at the Welcome Center following church services or see Pastor Montesino for more information. You can also pick up a postcard to learn more. If it's your first time joining us here at Church of All Nations, you can fill out the form you receive from our ushers. Please bring it to the Welcome Center in the lobby after service. We want to connect with you. There's so many great events coming up, so check out our bulletin, our social media, our website, and our church app. And with that, let's get back to our service.
Amen. Praise God. Good morning, church family. It's always good to be in the house of the Lord. And now is the time that in our service where we continue to worship the Lord by bringing our tithes and our offerings to God. And church, I want us to take another moment to give our youth fine arts team another big round of applause. Give Pastor David a big round of applause. We're so proud of all the fine arts team students and also the leaders. And we're blessed at Church of All Nations and proud that we are not only a multicultural church, but also a multi-generational church. Amen? Every member of the family is important at Church of All Nations. Children, youth, young adults, single adults, married couples, parents, seniors, single adults, every single one is important. Amen? But today, I want to encourage you and thank you so much for supporting our young people. As Pastor David said, our young people. And the older I get, the more I realize and understand the importance of investing in our young people and the next generation, the now generation, but it's also the future generation. So thank you for your support for our young people. Psalm 145, verse 4 says, "One generation will commend your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts." Church is always vital for us to invest in the next generation. And our faithful giving at Church of All Nations not only supports our own financial well-being, the daily operations of the church, evangelism and missions, but it also is an investment in our children, youth, young adults, and our young people. Amen. Our tithes and offerings support the next generation of believers who will take the lead for Christ in the future and who need ministry, equipping, and training more than ever before. This generation, more than ever before, needs our support. And I want to encourage, if I can, each and every one of us today to support our young people. And it could be somebody younger than us, but it could be our children, youth, young adults. What can we do? Our next generation is full of potential and promise, but they need our support. What can we do? We can pray for our young people in our families, in our church. Amen? Prayer is powerful. Pray for our young people. We can volunteer in our children, youth, and young adults ministries. See P. Vic. See Pastor David. See Pastor Cooper. See Pastor Jamil. There's plenty of opportunities where you can invest your time, treasure, your experience in a young person. Three, we can provide encouragement to the young people around us by taking time to acknowledge them, speak to them, and listen to them. When you see a young person in the community or at church, say hello to that young person. Get to know that young person. Encourage that young person. It'll make a difference in their lives. And number four, we can generously support our local church where our young people are ministered to, discipled, and given opportunities, as we've seen, to use their gifts to glorify God and to reach others. Amen. Let's reach out to our young people. As we bring our tithes and offerings to the Lord today, let us remember that our giving is not only for us and for today, but our giving is making an impact on the next generation of believers who will continue God's work and declare his mighty acts in the future. The success of the next generation is up to us now, amen? And we can make an impact. We want to thank you again for your generous giving. If you're here in the sanctuary, Church of All Nations, you can deposit your tithes and offerings in the bags that will be passed through the aisles. And if you're watching online, thank you for your generous giving as well. God bless you. You can give on the five ways that you'll see on your screen. Let us pray. Father, in Jesus' name, thank you, the God of generations. Thank you that one generation will commend your mighty works to another, Lord, and you shall receive glory, honor, and praise. Help us to be those, Lord, who invest in the next generation, oh God. Help us to be faithful by bringing our tithes and our offerings, which will support discipleship, equipping, training of our young people and all of us, that we can do your will and your work, that we can reach this generation for Christ. Lord, thank you for each giver. Thank you for each gift that is given for the building up of your kingdom. Lord, I thank you. You're going to bless each one because you're a God who rewards and honors giving and is faithful to provide for all our needs. We praise you and we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. We all said, amen. God bless you and thank you for your giving.
to destroy me, try to make me fall. He puts me in a rut, out of the reach of the most. When my enemy try to hurt me, I don't have to worry, 'cause I'm in his care, not just here, but everywhere. I go to the hiding place, where I seek my God's face, outside of chains to go. Don't you know he carries me? He comforts me.
Applause. We have a good God. He is our light and our salvation. He's so good to us. We thank God for this wonderful church family that we have at Church of All Nations. Each and every one of you is a blessing. But this Tuesday is a very special occasion as Pastor Boykin and Pastor Beth celebrate 36 years of marriage. Can we give them a big round of applause? Pastor Boykin, please come. Pastor Beth, please come. We want to pray for you today. We want to pray for this very special couple, the first family of Church of All Nations. They need our prayers, amen? They need our prayers. So please make it your daily act to pray for Pastor Boykin and Pastor Beth and their family. We have a special card for you on behalf of your church staff and some flowers for you as well. And we pray that you will have a wonderful day on Tuesday. Can we please stand as we pray for Pastor Boykin and Pastor Beth? Let's stretch forth our hands to them, can we? Let us pray. Father, in Jesus' mighty name, we thank you for Pastor Boykin and Pastor Beth. Thank you for bringing them together for your purposes and plans, Lord, and what you have put together. Let no man, let nothing tear asunder. We thank you for 36 years of marriage this week, and we thank you that their love is growing more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, and we pray your blessing upon them, Lord, first for their marriage, Lord, that they would continue to have growing intimacy, communication, unity, love, all those things that make a strong and growing marriage. Thank you that they are a reflection and an example to us of Jesus Christ and the church, of love, commitment, submission, partnership, teamwork, all the things, Lord God, that are good, Lord, between Christ and the church. And we pray your blessing upon them. Good health, peace, joy, righteousness, bless them and their family. Thank you for many more years, Lord, of marriage and blessings for them. We thank you for them and we praise you in Jesus' mighty name. And we all said, amen, amen. Let's give Pastor Boykin, Pastor Beth another big round of applause. Happy anniversary.
Oh my goodness. After that prayer that he prayed that she will, I don't know, that will do, I feel like I got to step it up as a wife. In fact, you need to pray that again because I didn't get the complete list of all the things we need to be doing, right? Thank you, Pastor Mark. He's always so precious and sweet. And I can't even keep up with all the gift cards he gives me to Jay Alexander. We have to go all the time because he's so wonderful. So thank you, Pastor Mark, and to everyone. I do want to mention, as you probably saw in the video a couple minutes ago, I think some of you are probably pasta people. You like Italian food. I think there's probably a few in here, amen? No, it's all beans and rice? Come on, raise your hand. You know you love Italian. Okay, because we've done some beans and rice in this church. So I said this time that we finally have a chance to have our Cohen Cafe, and the music department in music and media is doing all of our food next week. And we have Chef Angelo from our church. Angelo Mornelli, Adair Pinheiro, and James Carruthers are all doing the cooking. So it is going to be like top notch. In fact, Brother Angelo is here with me, right here. Yeah, there's our chef, okay? So next week, yes. So the choir is going to be in the lobby today with these little pre-tickets that you can buy early so that you can already claim your plate. We will have all kinds of things like penne a la vodka, baked ziti, all of these different good goodies, chicken marsala, I mean, all the good stuff, okay? And that will include your salad and your drink, and then there will be desserts for sale as well. So that's all for $15. So make sure that you get your ticket today. You can come after the first service. We'll start serving at that time. Or you can always get your to-go box and take it home for lunch. So we're making sure that we can have everybody enjoy this delicious food. And thank you so much in advance. Thanks.
Amen. Well, Pastor Mark, he just outdoes himself every Sunday, and what he does is he has the most wonderful pastoral heart of any man I have ever met. And I only got offended one time, and it was a group of people talking, and we were talking about hospitals and visitation, and someone said, "Wow, it must be very difficult, Pastor, for you to do all the visits and go to the hospital and make the phone calls and then have to put together three messages a week." And before I could even defend myself, one of the ladies says, "Oh, he doesn't pastor the church. Pastor Mark pastors the church. Pastor Boykin just preaches." So anyway, I didn't know what to say after that, but, you know, truth is stranger than fiction. Is that right? Anyway, and I must say, the staff that we have, they're incredible. Pastor David, they just got back last night after 11 o'clock from being up in Orlando for 3 days, singing, meeting, praying, and I'm so proud of all of these kids. I'm proud of David and Cooper and all of, and especially PVIC. He controls everything. He's got a phone with him at all times, and I am just so delighted. So could you give our staff a big round of applause? They do an incredible job. And I want you to know, because a lot of you have asked, you know, how is the television network going? And I have to tell you, folks, it is incredible what God is doing and the doors that are opening. And each week we have more doors, or like, for instance, this coming week, another cable network will be open for the United States. More independent stations are picking us up, and the hour of prayer on Friday is going to be extended from Monday through Friday, and Monday through Thursday right now, it's going to be a 30-minute program. It will be live, and we will be taking prayer requests, prayer needs, because we are seeing so many miracles. We are seeing miracles every single week. We get testimonies. We get phone calls. We get people who say, I can be at a party, and someone will come up to me and say, listen, I sent in a prayer need, and your people prayed for it, and God healed my mother, God healed my child, or whatever the need is. Folks, we are a praying church. Amen? And I want you to join me in praying for Radiant Life Television Network. That's what it is. And also, our Sunday messages are live, and we just thank God, and we say hello to people around the world, those through satellite. Many of them are watching at like 12 midnight where they are, and we thank God that these doors are open. But I'll be telling you next week, if you want to join in helping us to support Radiant Life Television Ministry, we are going to ask you, it's called Win 1040. And 1040 is the window around the world. It's really around the equator, where most of the world lives who have either never heard the gospel or have never heard enough of the gospel to make a decision. And so we're going to ask if you would pray and you would join Win 1040. And what that is that you say, I tithe, and we need you to tithe so that there might be meat in God's house. But we also, above our offerings to our missionaries, we're asking our people to consider giving $10 to $40 a month, whatever you can give, because that helps us with the price of satellite. And if you knew how much money most of the Christian networks pay, or in the past paid for their networks, it was in the millions. And now God has opened the door, and we figure that it could be anywhere from $6,000 to $12,000 if we cover the entire world with satellite. And then the cable networks here, most of them are opening their doors because you know what they're asking? They're asking for Christian programs that will preach the word and not sit on there and sell books, sell products, but will preach the word of God. And one way our doors have been opened, that God has opened, is because the one who's representing us, Clark Ortiz, has talked with so many. And the first question they ask him is, how much time do they spend begging for money? And he said, none. And they said, well, we have to see this. And so what we want to do, and there will always be an opportunity if people want to support from outside, we certainly could use that, but we need our people to believe in what God has done for us. Folks, we could not have done this in our own power if we had tried for 100 years. But how many of you know the Holy Spirit can open any door? Amen. Amen. So I'm going to ask you next week, please be here. And we want you to consider, if you can, and listen, we will not be calling and bothering you and saying, you made a pledge. That pledge is between you and God, and to know that it is spreading the gospel around the world. Amen. Folks, that's what it's all about. Can you say amen to that? So today, I want you to turn in your Bibles to Matthew 16, verse 17 and 18. And as we look at this, title of the message today is The Kind of Church Jesus is Building. You know what's interesting? You ask people, what kind of church do you attend? Oh, I go here because I like the music, or I like the seating, or I love the lights and the smoke, or I love the preaching, I love the fellowship. People have an idea of what they like, but that does not necessarily mean that is the kind of church Jesus is building. So we want to be New Testament. We want to be full gospel. We want to preach the truth from Genesis to Revelation without apology. Amen. We're not going to cherry pick messages that are just going to make people feel good. I want everyone here, when you leave on Sunday, I want you to feel edified. I want you to feel uplifted. I want you to feel like you have met with God and there's an anointing. But church, we're going to preach the full counsel of God without apology. Can you say amen to that? The kind of church Jesus is building. We begin with verse 17 of Matthew 16. This is Jesus as he is speaking to the apostles, and he directs his question here to Simon Peter. Listen, and Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Father, I pray that you would bless your word today. Make it applicable to our hearts. Let the Spirit of God overwhelm us with the anointing of your word. And may we know that this is the word of God and not the word of men. We thank you for your blessings. We thank you for your promise. And we thank you for your anointing. In Jesus' name. And everyone said amen. The church Jesus Christ is building may not be the church you and I have in mind. But the Bible makes clear that Jesus is building a certain type of church. Now listen carefully. Great numbers don't mean a great church. Just because there are great numbers, and I hear people, you hear people say it all the time. Oh, 3,000 here, 5,000 there, 10,000 there. And great numbers don't mean a great church, but do not misunderstand me. I'm all for big numbers. as it relates to salvation. Folks, it is not about entertaining. It is not about having the biggest choir, the best music, the most fellowship groups. What we are looking for is to fulfill the Great Commission, and God's will and God's desire is that every man, woman, boy, and girl would be saved. He came to earth not to entertain. He didn't simply come to do miracles. He came to do the greatest miracle of all, and that was to reconcile us to God, to bring salvation to the lost, to bring the bridge that was put between God and man, the sin, the failure, and to bring them together and reconcile everyone who is lost to Jesus Christ. I don't agree with all these people who say God is not for great numbers. That's not true. But it's not God's will that any man should perish. I'm sure God's ideal would be a true church on every corner with the optimum number, but every church is not a New Testament church. Just because it has church on the marquee are on the wall does not mean it is a New Testament church. God wants every city, every village, every nation, and he longs for people to be reached by the church. Folks, the church, we are God's hand extended. You hear the word dispensation a lot. And I might add, in one of our circle groups, we have a group that is studying apologetics. I think they had somewhere between 11 and 15 their first week here. But it teaches how you witness to someone who already says to you, oh, I don't even believe in the Bible. And it teaches you how you share the gospel with those who have completely turned their back or turned their ears off to hearing the gospel. So you should look up at many of the groups that we have back there. But do you know it is estimated that 30,000 people heard the word of God and believed and were baptized within 12 months in the city of Jerusalem in the first church after Pentecost. Did you hear that? In 1 year's time, 30,000 people heard the word of God and believed and were baptized in 12 months in the city of Jerusalem after Pentecost. Can you say amen? Amen. And that's why Jesus, before he ascended into glory, he said, do not leave Jerusalem until you be endued with what? Power. Be endued with the Holy Spirit. He will give you power to be witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, the uttermost parts of the earth. Hallelujah. Folks, we are still under that mandate today. This is our Jerusalem. God has given us his glorious gospel to share the love of Christ with your neighbor, with your coworker, with your relatives, with the neighbors. We are to share the good news that Jesus Christ loves you so much that he left the glories of heaven that he might come down in the form of a man and lead a sinless life, die for our sins, and arise the third day to seal our salvation. Now the word church, and you've heard me say this, is taken from the Greek word ekklesia, meaning called out ones. And they are a part of many churches around the world. I was reading not too long ago Reinhard Bonnke's book. I forget the title of it. It has fire in the title. But he said that the churches in Europe have become so cold and dead and indifferent that all of the great cathedrals that were built back in the 1500s, 1600s, all of these great cathedrals, they have services on Sunday just like we do. But they are so few people that go into the church that they had to put signs out in front of the church that says, "This church is not a museum." What a commentary. I wonder, in America, are we headed toward that? If it's not entertainment, "Pastor, if you don't say the right things, or if you offend me from the Word of God, then I'll simply leave and go home." Listen to me. As a minister of God, I am constrained to preach the whole counsel of God, to tell you what God has said from Genesis to Revelation, to tell you that God has empowered us with more power than any demon in hell, and we are in the midst of spiritual warfare even as I speak. Someone called me yesterday and was talking to me on the phone, and they work with a television station, a Christian station here in South Florida. And he said the first thing that he did when he became manager of the station was that he got a group of people together and he said, "I'm not even going to begin this job until first we have bathed this station in oil and have prayed that the powers and principalities of the air are broken over this station so the gospel can get free, because, folks, we are in a spiritual warfare. You may not see it with the naked eye, but spiritually we are in a battle, and we've been given the victory through the power of the Holy Spirit." I said, through the power of the Holy Spirit. That means we pray for the sick. When someone comes to the church and the doctor has told them, "I'm sorry to tell you, you have stage 4 cancer." They go to a lot of churches, and there are churches in this city that we have had people who came to this church after going to the leadership, the pastor and the elders, and saying, "Would you pray for me? I've been diagnosed with cancer," only to hear the elder or the pastor say, "I'm sorry, I cannot pray for something I do not believe God does today." You say, "Oh, you're saying," no. This week, in fact, Someone called me and said, they told me a relative of theirs had cancer. And I said, "Well, you know, give me the name." And I have a book that I keep, a journal. I actually have 2 or 3, because at church I have people approach me at home. And so they said, "I can find out more, but let me find out and I'll let you know." And I was seated and at a luncheon, and this man came by and leaned over and he said, "Pastor, it's stage 4 cancer. And the doctors have told him there's nothing more that they can do for them." But you know what? He also added, "But I know a man who can heal this brother of mine. I know the power of the Holy Spirit. I know the power of God. And I'm not going to simply pray that he's comfortable and that he doesn't feel pain, although nobody wants to feel pain, but God can heal him even with stage 4 cancer. God can heal him." Hallelujah. Let me tell you, nothing gave me greater joy than, I think it was 4 weeks ago now, on a Sunday morning, one of the men in our church whom we had been praying for, he was going in for surgery because he had a malignant tumor on his brain. And he called me on a Sunday morning. I didn't pick up in time. He left the message and he said, "Pastor Boykin, this is Brother So-and-so." And he said, "I went in Tuesday and they were going in to the brain to see if they could get or pull the malignancy or the malignant tumor out of his brain. And the doctor or surgeon said, before we do that, I want to take another scan." And he said they put me in, I think it was a CAT scan or an MRI, I don't remember which one. And he said the surgeon came in and he dropped the, you know, the little face mask. He said, "I don't understand it." And he said, what is it?" He said, "That thing has shrunk less than half that it was when we have been diagnosing this thing." And our brother said to him, "Well, what do you recommend?" He said, "I recommend nothing." He said, "That thing is going into remission, so we're not going to touch it. We're going to let it continue until it is finally gone." Listen, God has given us power through the Holy Spirit, and we need to take that power, lay hands upon the sick, witness to the lost, fellowship with those who don't know Christ, and tell them there's a God who loves them. There's a God who can reconcile their marriage and bring their family together. Hallelujah. Now let me tell you, folks, the foundation of the church Jesus is building is not Simon Peter. That is not what Jesus said. If you look in verse 16, or verse 15 rather, Jesus asked the apostles, "Whom do men say that I am?" Some say Isaiah, some say Jeremiah, the prophet. And then he turned to Simon Peter and he said, "But whom say ye that I am?" Simon Peter, whom do you say that I am? Now listen, here's what he said. "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus returned by saying, "Blessed art thou, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say this unto thee, that thou art Peter." And here Jesus is playing off of the words. Peter is Petra, a little rock. But upon this declaration, this Petros, like the rock of Gibraltar, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail. He did not say, "Peter, upon you, I'm going to build the church and the gates of hell shall not prevail." He did not say that. He said, "You are a small rock, but upon this rock of Gibraltar, the declaration that thou art Christ, the Son of the living God, I will build my church and the very gates of hell shall not prevail against it." Amen. How many can say amen to that? Amen. Peter's statement of divine revelation of Jesus Christ is what Jesus said he would build his church upon. And Jesus said, "Not flesh and blood, but the power of God will build my church and nothing shall stop it." Amen. The foundation of the church isn't Peter. It isn't the Catholic Church. It isn't the Southern Baptist Convention. It isn't the General Council, the Assemblies of God. It's upon that statement. And Jesus said to him, "Peter, Flesh and blood did not reveal that to you. You could not know that by carnality, simply by feeling. You know that by the Spirit of God that has enlightened you and spoken through you and upon this declaration, I'll build my church. Hallelujah. I'm watching the time very carefully. If I don't finish this week, I'll finish it next week. Let us look at the church that Jesus is building. Number one, it's a praying church. I want everyone to say, it was a praying church. They were a praying people. You go back to Acts and read the account. The Holy Spirit worked. Miracles took place. Supernatural manifestations appeared. Why? Because they were empowered through the Holy Ghost and prayer. Folks, without the Holy Spirit, all I can do is stand up here and tell you nice stories. Without the Holy Spirit, our music is just entertainment. It's just pretty music, nothing more, until the Holy Spirit anoints it. You're witnessing. Without the Holy Spirit, you can't save anyone. Do you hear what I'm saying? Yes, we are preachers. The Bible says, how shall they know unless someone tells them? And how shall they know that unless a preacher is sent? But the preacher must have the anointing of the Holy Spirit upon him. When Philip went down to Gaza, left this great revival in Samaria, people were being healed. Spirits were coming out. Demon-possessed people were being healed. Everyone that they brought to Philip as he prayed for them, they were healed, they were delivered, and there was revival through Samaria. They even sit down, Peter and John, and they told them when they got there about the Spirit of God. And they asked them, have you been baptized in the Holy Spirit since you were saved? I want to ask you that. Have you been baptized in the Holy Spirit since you've been saved? You say, I don't even know what that is. And that's what they said to Peter and John. And they explained to them the promise of the Holy Spirit, because it was Philip's preaching, anointing, and the Spirit of God upon Philip where people were being healed. And as faith was released, people were delivered. They were healed. Blind eyes open. But then something miraculous happened. God sent Philip from this great revival in Samaria down to Gaza. Gaza, not a city, not a town, a desert. Now, let me tell you something. No man is going to leave a revival and go down into a desert unless the Holy Spirit speaks to that man or woman. And Philip was in tune with the Holy Spirit. And when he said, go to Gaza, he went down to Gaza. And when he was there, he saw a man in a chariot reading Isaiah chapter 53. What did Philip do? He started running alongside the chariot. Look at this picture. Do you know who this man was? He was the treasurer of Candace, the queen of Ethiopia, the exchequer. He was a eunuch. He's reading because he's been to Jerusalem to worship. He's hungry for God. And as he's reading, I'm sure when he was in Jerusalem, I'm sure that his curiosity, his desire was piqued, but he had no one to tell him what the scripture meant. And when he came alongside Philip, Philip asked him, what are you reading? And he told him, and he said, do you understand? He said, no, how can I unless a man tells me? He got in the chariot with him, And he took the scripture from Isaiah 53 and he explained more fully the ministry of Jesus Christ and the promise of the church. And the eunuch said, "Here is water. What would forbid me from being baptized?" Church, when you are saved, you don't wait 6 months to be baptized. When you are saved, you don't wait a year to be baptized. When you are saved, you need to be baptized as soon as possible. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Someone told me the other day they led family members to the Lord who had been lost. Some had been away from God, but some had never received Christ. And when this brother shared the gospel with them and they accepted Christ as Savior, they asked, "Why can't we go out in the pool and be baptized?" And they went out and baptized them right there. Can you say amen? Amen. I have to tell you a story. When I was in Harlem, I was asked to preach, and it was to be a convocation of several churches in one building. But before I preached, they were going to have a baptismal service. And so the pastor said, you know, he told me before, and he said, "Can you get some shorts?" And I had some shorts on. And he said, "Okay, we're going down to the basement." And I thought, wow, I've never heard of a baptismal down in the basement. And so we go down there, and it was packed. Everyone was standing around, and so I couldn't see that I was looking for the baptismal fount. So I'm, you know, pressing through, and when I get to the middle, I realize it was a kiddie pool, like this high. And I was so confused by how in the world am I going to baptize someone in 10 inches of water. I mean, so I look at the pastor, and he said, "Pastor Boykin," and, you know, greeted all the people. "Now he's going to baptize Pastor Boykin." So I get in the pool, and I'm trying to kill time to think, how am I going to do this? I mean, they weren't kids. They were grown-ups. And so I read some scripture, and, you know, I read some more scripture, and I read some more scripture, and finally, I gave up, and I fell on my knees, just like this. And so they have the first one, and it's a lady, and they said, whatever her name, Sister So-and-so, get in there with Pastor Boykin. So she comes and stands, and I said, "Would you please get on your knees?" "Yes, Pastor Boykin." And I said, "Could you scoot over here close to me?" She said, "Yes, Pastor Boykin." And so I said, you know, "Have you received Christ as your Savior?" "Yes." "And do you believe Jesus Christ is the Son of God, that he died on the cross according to Scripture, he rose again the third day?" "Yes." And so now I baptize. So when I went to baptize her, I pushed her down, and I couldn't get her up. She was underwater. So I pulled up as much as I could. I hope you're not getting this on. You're not getting this on film. And this is how it looked. I'm ashamed to say, but I went down with her. And pulled her over on top of me and pushed her up. And I'm looking, and I'm getting up like this, like a drunk man. And I see there are three more. I did the second one. And finally, one of the ministers came up to me and said, "Pastor, why don't you just sit in the pool and have them sit next to you and dunked them that way, and I wanted to turn around and say, why didn't you tell me this in the beginning? They were snapping pictures. Pictures, here I am pushing this woman up. I've never seen it on Facebook, but if it's on Facebook, I'm going to lie and say it wasn't me. I'm sorry. But hear me. After Pentecost came, 120 believers were in the upper room waiting for the promise of the Lord. And what were they doing? These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication. The very first characteristic you read about in the church, Jesus is building, is prayer. Without prayer, we can do nothing. Jesus said in John 10, without me, you can do nothing. I am the vine, you are the branches. But without me, you can do nothing. You can't witness, you can't preach, you can't sing, you can't testify unless the Spirit of God is giving you the anointing, the power to overcome every contingency of the enemy. Jesus' victory at Calvary was won on his knees in Gethsemane when he prayed great sweat drops of prayer. I've never seen that kind of prayer. I've been in a lot of prayer meetings. I've never seen anyone pray with the intensity that Jesus prayed, where rather than sweat drops, it's sweat drops of blood. Do you realize the intensity of what Jesus was doing? He was saying, if there's any way that I can bring salvation without drinking the cup of sin and being separated from my Father, then Lord, let it be. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. That is the greatest prayer you can pray. Lord, I'm looking for a new job. I want you to promote me. I want you to move us to another place. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. Some of you right now, you're having to pray that prayer. You have a mountain before you and you're saying, I just need to get away. I just need to move away. I need another job. I need another placement. But have you prayed the prayer that Jesus prayed? Nevertheless, that's the hardest prayer to pray. Lord, I know that this is going to change, and I know that my marriage, you know, we've come to an end, and there's no hope. We just need to get a divorce, and just we need to split the, you know, our assets, and we need to go our different ways. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. When you pray that prayer in certainty in your own life, it's a very different thing. The night before Daniel's first surgery, my son, when he was 12, I stayed up all night. The night before Beth stayed in the hospital, I stayed in the hotel. And I prayed, and it wasn't a quid pro quo. And most of you know what I mean by that. It's bargaining with God. God, you do this. And I've been with moms and dads. I've been with family members who've said those exact words. Oh, God, if you'll just heal my son, then I'll serve you. I'll go overseas. I'll minister. I'll work in the church if you'll just heal my son. That wasn't my prayer. Oh, yes, I asked God to heal my son, of course. But here was my prayer. I said, God, and this was 4 a.m. God, I'm not getting up from this floor unless you give me the peace that in your will, if you choose to take my son, and I pray to God, you don't. But if you do, I want to walk out of this hotel room with the peace of God that I can stand over his dead, cold body and lift my arms, as Job said, and say, the Lord giveth, the Lord taketh, blessed be the name of the Lord. Folks, let me tell you, God is in control. And when I walked out of that room, I had a peace in my heart. There was no doubt I was in the will of God. There was nothing more that needed to be said. And when we got there, we laid hands upon him, and he went through an 8-hour surgery, and he came out completely healed, had a second one 4 years later, and he was playing the guitar in the service 20 or 30 minutes ago. Lastly, and I'm going to close today with this. It was a giving church. Acts chapter 4. In the midst of the praying, the power, the gift, salvation, let us not lose sight of the characteristic of giving. Acts chapter 2, verse 45 says they sold their possessions and brought the proceeds to the church. Notice their type of giving. It was first liberally. There was no need that was not met. There was no need in the church that was not met. The church should never go without fulfilling the needs of the church. I don't care if it's air conditioners. I don't care if it's a new window, a new door. If it is a need, we need to fill it, because God is able. God is able. I say this, and I'm going to copy Pastor Oldacre, because he said it to me, and it has stuck in my mind and spirit ever since he said it. He was talking about Elisha when the woman, they ran out of money, or her husband died, and she had no money, and the debtors were going to come and take her two sons as slave labor. And when she went to the man of God, Elisha, she said, look, the son of the prophet, my husband, he died. We have no money. I have two sons. I have debts. And the debtors are going to come and make my sons slaves. What shall I do, oh man of God? The question he asked, listen, first thing he said was, what is in your house? What is in your house? He didn't say, do you have a rich uncle? Do you have some friends you can go borrow money from? He said, what is in your house? And as Pastor Oldacre said, Pastor, don't be deceived. Everything you need in this church can be found in the church. Can be found right here. And you know what? That hit me right between the eyes. We've had times when we have said, we have a need. Received an offering, and it would go over the top of what it was we would need. Everything that you need, hear me, is in your hands. You say, all I have are two mites. Two mites is all I have. Jesus said, the woman who had two mites, she gave more than everyone else in the synagogue. Two mites. But are you willing to give to God? Are you willing to give to God? You don't have a problem. You can go down to the coffee shop and you can spend $7 on a coffee drink and think nothing of it. You can leave a tip under a dirty dish in a restaurant, more money than you give to the kingdom of God. Folks, that's not right. When the Spirit gets a hold of you, it's like Barnabas. He had land, and he went, and he sold it, and he brought the proceeds, and he laid them at the feet of the apostles. It met their need. Everything you need today is right here in the house of God. Some of you need salvation. is in the house of God. Some of you right now, you need to be filled with the baptism of the Holy Spirit. He's here today. He's here, and he's not a respecter of persons. What he's done for me, he will do for you. I want everyone to stand to their feet right now. Everyone standing. Holy Spirit, move through this house. Holy Spirit, touch everyone. Touch every heart. Move your people to the answer that they need by the power of the Holy Spirit. Father, this is your house. This is your house. And you said, I will not allow God's house to be turned into a den of thieves. Folks, this is not a circus. This is not an entertainment hour. This is not something we try to get you in here so we can thrill you with what we've brought in. It's the Spirit of God that will transform lives. That means God is going to heal right now. And I'm going to ask, heads bowed and eyes closed, I'm going to ask, is there anyone here today who is away from God? You don't know Christ as your Savior. Would you raise your hand up and down very quickly? Yes, thank you. Anyone else? Anyone else? Just raise your hand up and down very quickly. The second thing is, there's someone here right now, and you are suffering from some abdominal pain. There is something in the right side of your stomach, and it involves the intestines. You've been to the doctor. They've given a prognosis, but you still have the pain, and it's caused from the intestines, but it's the right side of the abdomen. I'm going to ask, if that is you, I want you to step out and come to the front right now. Just come and stand in the front. God is going to heal you. I have my anointing oil. When I was praying about this message, the one thing the Spirit of God said to me is, take your anointing oil. And you anoint those who are sick in body. I'm going to wait for, and the one who raised your hand, just come forward with the others. There is a woman who is suffering from inner ear infection. There's dizziness. There are times when you have to be seated because of the dizziness of the inner ear. You've been battling this for at least 6 months. I'm going to ask you to step out and come forward. If that is you, step out and come forward right now. How many of you believe God can heal? God can heal inner ear. God can heal an abdomen. He can certainly save a lost soul. His Spirit is here today. Precious Holy Spirit, move upon your people.
There is none like you.
Can we have all of the altar workers come? I want the pastor
no one
to stand
else
in front.
Can touch my heart like you do.
I'm going to ask the pastors to come and stand.
I can search
We're going to pray in the name of
Jesus.
How many of you believe God is going to heal today? The power of God is here to heal. God is here to reconcile. God is here to break any stronghold in our lives in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What do you have need of?
No one else can touch my heart like you do. I can search for all eternity long. There is none like you.
Right now, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Anita, I anoint you with oil.
There is none like you.
Lord, there is nothing you cannot heal that you cannot do. And in Jesus' name, I cast out any infirmity. You are healed by the blood of Jesus. You are healed by the blood of Jesus. Put your hand on your stomach right where it is. In the name of Jesus, I declare healing. You are going to feel a relief.
I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you.
Amen. Let's pray right now. Father, in the name
I could search for all eternity long.
Both of her
and
I pray,
find
God, the infection.
There is none.
I pray the nerve.
Like
Lord, whatever is causing the dizziness. Whatever is causing her discomfort, right now we break and shatter every contingency of the enemy in the name of Jesus, by the blood of the Lamb. By the blood of the Lamb, you are healed. You are healed in the name of Jesus. Of this cancer in your body, that it would be eradicated, that it would go into total remission, it would disappear in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. May I hold the phone? Church, we're praying for someone in Port St. Lucie who's been diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. I want everyone to stretch their hands. God is going to touch him and heal him right now. I want you to curse that infirmity and declare healing by the blood of Jesus and the word of our testimony. Would you pray with me right now? Father, in Jesus' name, Raul is healed by the blood of Jesus. Lord, cancer is removed. Sickness is removed. Infirmity is removed.
He reaches to the highest mountain.
Hallelujah. Give God praise right now.
One
more person I want to pray. There's someone who is having problems with your right eye. It's not only that you're having blurriness, you cannot see completely out of your right eye. Whether it's blood behind the eye, it's not the lens, it's behind the eye. and you've seen the doctor. They're trying procedures, but I want to pray for you right now. If that is you, I want you to come forward. It's your right eye that you have had problems with. Hallelujah. Is that you? Everyone, stretch your hand forward. We're going to pray. Kathy, because of your faith in Jesus Christ, we anoint you with oil. I anoint your eye right now in the name of Jesus. This eye is healed by the blood of Jesus, by your own testimony. You are healed in Jesus' name. Oh, la la la. Healed in Jesus' name. Healed by the power of God. Healed by the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Oh, la 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 la. How many can say amen? She is healed in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Yes. Pastor Mark, come on. White noise would leave and your ear would be healed in the name of Jesus. Whatever is causing this discomfort and the sounds that you hear will disappear in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. I don't care if you walk out and it gets worse. You are healed and the power of God is going to completely eradicate this from your ear in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, I declare it. Hallelujah. How many can give praise to God right now? I'm going to close the service, but if there are any that need prayer in the second service, I'll be praying longer in the second service. But I want to pray right now that the power of God would fill every one of you. Listen to me. If you have not been baptized in the Holy Spirit, it's not some kind of a trick. It's not learning to twist your tongue a certain way. It's that you praise the name of Jesus. As you pray and your tongue is loosened, you will begin to utter a sound that you've never heard before, coming deep within you, coming from deep within you. And God is going to fill you. Jesus is the baptizer. He will baptize you in Jesus' name. Father, as we leave today, I pray miracles will continue to happen as people walk out those doors. I pray that they would go home and they would feel the healing virtue of Jesus Christ. And Lord, we do not doubt, we do not fear, we stand upon the solid rock in the name of Jesus. And everyone said amen, amen, amen and amen. May the Lord bless each one of you. God bless you.
Hey, we want to say thank you for joining us today here online. We hope and pray it made an impact on you. If it did help you or encourage you in any way, we'd love for you to share it with others. Make sure to subscribe to the Cone Boca YouTube page, follow us on Instagram, and stay connected with us on Facebook, our website, and app. If you have decided to follow Jesus today, please email us at info@bocachurch.com and let us know. If you have a prayer request or testimony, or this is your first time joining us today, you can also email us there. We love you. God bless and have a great week.